Hi, this is Dr. Rajeshwar from YR Pharma Tube. This is the third and final lecture on physicochemical properties in relation to biological activity. In the last two videos, we discussed the physicochemical properties such as solubility, partition coefficient, ionization, dissociation constant, and the chemical structural parameters such as resonance and inductive effect, oxidation reduction potential, various types of bonds, isosterism and bioisosterism, and their influence on biological activity. In this video, I want to tell you about spatial considerations such as molar dimensions and interatomic distances, stereochemistry, molar refractivity, and some miscellaneous physicochemical properties like drug shape, complexation, surface tension, and protein binding. As per the title, all these parameters are more often related to the area and space, sometimes the surface, of the drug molecules that influence the biological activity. Going to the details. Introduction. Most drugs must bind or otherwise interact with receptor sites and the reactive sites of enzymes which have characteristic and specific topological, that is, surface structural features. It is therefore not surprising that the steric requirements for designing effective drug molecules are often quite rigorous. The steric requirements relating to the special arrangement of atoms in a molecule, it affects the chemical reaction. These steric effects are non-bonding interactions that influence the shape and reactivity of ions and molecules. Electronic distribution patterns also determine certain aspects of structure. Electronic distribution means the distribution of electrons within the molecule. Thus, knowledge of these factors become important in understanding drug activity and in rationally designing new agents. In addition, studies of steric requirements have given us insight into the nature of various receptors. Molecular dimensions and interatomic distances. Much of our theoretical knowledge of distances between atoms in molecules, bond angles, diameters of atoms, and even volumes of functional groups have been confirmed and refined by X-ray crystallographic methods, especially X-ray diffraction studies. Many proteins, such as enzymes, are coiled into an alpha helix. Each amide or peptide is linked to the third amide groups down the peptide chain by hydrogen bonds. X-ray studies have shown that each complete turn of the coil contains 3.6 amino acid residues. The distance between two such consecutive turns is 5.4 to 5.5 angstroms. Furthermore, the distance between two such consecutive peptide bonds in an extended protein chain is 3.6 angstroms. It is now widely accepted that the receptors that interact with drugs to produce a drug reaction are largely protein in nature. Thus, the two distances between helical turns and peptide bonds assume potential significance in the mechanism of action at the molecular level. It is possibly more than coincidence that a considerable number of drugs have functional groups believed to be involved in receptor complexation that are separated by distances that are multiples of the previously stated dimensions. These agents include compounds of such diverse pharmacology as antihistamines, example diphenhydramine, antispasmodics such as edaphenine, cholinergics such as carbachol, and local anesthetics like procaine. The 3.6 angstroms distance is also encountered in drugs having a quaternary cationic nitrogen. For example, cholinergics such as carbachol has 7.2 angstroms and cholinergic blocking agents. In curare-like agents such as dexamethasone, the distance is a double length of acetylcholine, that is 4 into 3.6 angstroms is equal to 14.4 angstroms. There are many other instances. A striking example of similar molecular dimensions involve the elucidation of the role of PABA in bacterial biochemistry and the action of sulfanilamide in antagonizing it. Stereochemistry. Optical isomers are frequently referred to as enantiomers or enantiomers. Optical isomers are the isomers that have the same chemical formula but differ in their arrangement of atoms or groups within the molecule, and they have non-superimposable mirror images. Enantiomers are enantiomorphs, they are the mirror images to each other. A racemic modification or a racemate is a mixture of equal parts of enantiomers, that is plus and minus, and is therefore optically inactive. An optically pure isomer can be racemized usually by drastic means such as heat, acid, or alkali treatment. A molecule with two non-identical asymmetric centers can exist as four stereoisomers as per 2 to the power n formula for stereoisomers, that is, as two different racemates. Enantiomers from either of the racemates cannot exist in a mirror image relationship. Such enantiomers are referred to as diastereomers, which means each of a pair of stereoisomeric compounds that are not mirror images of one another, which are illustrated by the drug ephedrine. Note that dextroephedrine and levoephedrine are mirror images of each other, yet they are not superimposable. They represent enantiomers, and if they are mixed in equimolar proportions would be a racemate, that is a racemic modification, which is also known as recipedrine. The other mirror image pair is dextropseudoephedrine and levopseudoephedrine. On the other hand, dextroephedrine and dextropseudoephedrine are not mirror images and are therefore diastereoisomers. They even have different physical properties, with the former melting at 40 degrees centigrade with a specific rotation minus 50 degrees. Since we perceive interactions of drugs with receptor surfaces with definitive topographical features, it is not surprising the several ephedrine isomers do not possess equal quantitative and even qualitative activity. Clinically, dextroephedrine is used to a large extent as an anti-asthmatic drug and formerly as a prazosin to restore low blood pressure as a result of trauma and other causes. Levopseudoephedrine is used primarily as a nasal decongestant. The ephedrines also have varying degrees of CNS stimulant activities. Table shows the relative intensities of the pressor activity of the various ephedrines and their racemates. Geometric isomers. Geometric isomers are the isomers or the compounds which differ from each other in the arrangement of groups with respect to a double bond, ring, or other rigid structure. This represents rotational stability about the ethylenic bond produced by sp2 orbital hybridized carbon atoms. Since free rotation about the carbon-to-carbon axis is not possible, two stable forms of the molecule can now exist. The six components of both forms are in the same plane. The orientations of substituents X and Y relative to each other, however, will differ by 180 degrees. Unlike an enantiomeric pair of isomers, cis and trans isomers differ in both physical and even chemical properties, for example pKa, if X is a carboxyl group. Interactions with receptors will differ greatly, even to the point of no binding. This should not be surprising when considering that the distance between X and Y may not be the same in the two isomers. Restriction of a bond rotation between two carbon atoms resulting in cis-trans isomerism can also be imposed by the rigidity of alicyclic rings. Using a simple example such as 1,2-dimethyl cyclopropane, the cis isomer finds both the methyl groups above or below the plane of the ring. In the trans isomer, they are situated one above and one below the planar surface of the ring. Since it is possible to draw an imaginary plane of symmetry through either isomer, there is no chirality and therefore no optical isomers exist. A more interesting the complex drug example is 2-phenylcyclopropylamine. The drug chemically related to amphetamine is a potent inhibitor of the enzyme monoamine oxidase, abbreviated as MAO. Its clinical use in the treatment of severe depression. The compound exists as two geometrical isomers, that is cis and trans. Unlike dimethyl cyclopropane, where reflection symmetry exists for each geometric isomer, here, because of the presence of the two different substituents, each isomer is chiral and therefore resolvable into a pair of enantiomers. The trans pair is the stronger inhibitor and is marketed as the racemate. The cis isomers exhibit much weaker enzyme inhibition. One possibility for this decreased effectiveness is a partial eclipsing of the two functions due to their proximity to each other. It is important to differentiate the terms configuration and conformation. Configurations can best be thought of as set in their ways, that is, stabler relationships of groups to each other in space. Cis-trans isomers fit into this category, especially as seen in the case of alicyclic rings such as the 1,2-dimethylcyclopropane and trianyl cypromine. Interconversion of these isomers cannot occur without bond breaking. In conformations, changes of relative special positions of substituents are also most totally unhindered because of free rotation around single bonds. Impedance, if any, is very small. Energy barriers are 1 to 2 kilocalories per mole. If the groups are bulky, the barriers are somewhat higher, making certain positions, that is, conformers or rotamers, somewhat more favored. Such steric effects usually mean that favored conformations are those where such groups are at maximum distances from each other. This is called a staggered conformation. However, in cases where such functional groups may be subject to weak interactions such as hydrogen bonds, the stability patterns may shift. Because of the ease of conformer interchangeability, they are possible to isolate. However, they are useful in conceptualizing drug interactions with receptors and other biopolymeric surfaces. An early idea that evolved was that only one conformer was likely to have the best fit to interact maximally with the receptor. This concept was subsequently superseded by the assumption that even in the case of a rigid receptor requirement, the binding drug molecule whose lowest energy, that is most stable conformer, might not have the best goodness to fit could easily change to more favorable conformations. Since energy barriers to such conformational changes are so low, the energies needed to affect the changes are available. They can even be released by the binding process itself. In addition, the probability that receptor and macromolecular surfaces are also flexible further minimized the requirement for a lowest energy conformer for effective drug receptor binding. Molar refractivity. The molar refractivity, which is abbreviated as MR, is also sometimes referred to as molar refraction. The molar refractivity is the molar volume corrected by the refractive index. Now the question arises, what is refraction? Refraction is the bending of the path of a light wave as it passes across the boundary separating two media. As seen in the picture, a pencil is kept in a bottle of water and we see the pencil is refracted to certain angle, that is theta, shown in the other picture. Refraction is caused by the change in speed. Refractive index is the ratio of how much faster is in space compared to a specific medium. Molar refractivity represents size and polarizability of a fragment or molecule. In an atom-based approach, each atom of the molecule is assigned to a particular class with addition contributions to the total value of MR. Thus, it is a constitutive additive property that is calculated by Lorentz formula, that is MR is equal to n square minus 1 by n square plus 1 into MW by D, where n is the observed refractive index, MW is the molecular weight, and D is the density of the compound or any crystal, and MR is independent of temperature. Therefore, MR is determined from the refractive index, that is N, the molecular weight MW, and the density of the compound, that is D. Since refractive index does not change much for organic molecules, the term is dominated by the molecular weight and density. Thus, larger molecular weight, larger the steric effect, and the greater the density. A smaller molecular refractivity for the same molecular weight indicates stronger interactions in the crystal, or larger density indicates that the packing is better due to stronger interactions. For a radiation of infinite wavelength, the molecular refractivity represents the real volume of the molecules. Molecular refractivity is related not only to the volume of the molecules, but also to the London dispersive forces that acts in the drug receptor interactions. This method has been widely used in QSAR studies. Drug shape. The shape of the drug is an important factor in defining the nature of the drug receptor interaction. The 3D shape of the drug is thought to interact with a complementary structural binding region of the receptor, which is typically a protein. The specific nature of the interaction defines whether the drug acts as an agonist promoting a change in cellular function or as an antagonist which blocks the receptor, usually resulting in no direct biological effect. For example, consider a synthetic analog, benthanecol. Interaction of these molecules with the receptor, nicotinic or muscarinic cholinergic receptor, causes a physiological response, that is a decrease in heart rate. In contrast, a muscarinic antagonist such as atropine may bind even more tightly than acetylcholine to muscarinic receptor but causes no direct effect. However, following administration of antagonist, a biological response may be observed, as a result a receptor blockade. Complexation. The term complex is normally used in chemistry to denote a compound whose structure contains one or more metal ions or atoms to which electrically neutral or charged species are bonded, which includes chlorides, cyanides, water, ammonia, diaminoethane, etc. Complexes or coordination compounds result from a donor-receptor mechanism, that is, donating-accepting electron or an electron pair, or Lewis acid-base reaction, that is donating-accepting protons. For example, glycine forms complex with cupric ions. In the reaction, two coordinate covalent bonds are formed between glycine and copper in the complex. The nitrogen and oxygen atoms of glycine serve as the electron donating groups, each supplying an electron pair, whereas the cupric ion is the electron acceptor. Electron donating groups are always limited to oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur atoms. Electron acceptors include various bivalent and trivalent metals, particularly those of the transition group. The stability constant Ks reflects the strength of the interaction, and the larger the constant, the greater the stability. Stability of the metal ions in the complex has also been shown here. A ligand such as ammonia that has a single basic group capable of binding to the metal ion in an unidentate ligand. A ligand having more than one accessible basic binding site is multidentate. For example, ethylene diamine is a bidentate ligand form and chelates with the cupric ions. This use of term Ligand is not to be confused with its use to describe the species binding to a receptor. Some important multidentate structures have been listed here. The number of rings formed in the chelate depends on the electron donating groups. Sulfur can form the stable 4-member rings. Oxygen and nitrogen can form 5 and 6-member rings, but 5-member rings are generally more stable. Heavy metals are required for the following enzymes and biomolecular components. Complexes and complexing agents are being used on a variety of diseases. Chelating agents commonly used to treat cases of metal poisoning are ethylene diaminotetraacetic acid, that is EDTA, dimercaprol, and penicillamine, which is a degradative product of penicillin. The structure of EDTA contains amine and carboxylic acid groups, which means it readily coordinates with metals such as calcium and magnesium. Both of these elements are essential components of living organisms, and their depletion would result in the malfunctioning of a number of biological processes as well as weakening of the bone structure of mammals. Consequently, EDTA is normally used in the form of its disodium calcium EDTA salt in an attempt to reduce the calcium depletion. Dimercaprol. It has the thiol groups and so coordinates metal ions such as cadmium, mercury, and copper. However, the discovery of a natural detoxification process in bacteria resistant to mercury poisoning may result in a new genetic method of treatment for mercury poisoning. Penicillamine has thiol, amine, and carboxylate groups, and thus it is used in the treatment of Wilson's disease and in chronic cases of lead and mercury poisoning. Many metal complexes such as cisplatin has been found to exhibit anti-cancer activity. A number of copper complexes have been found to be active against rheumatoid arthritis. This anti-arthritic activity is believed to be due to their anti-inflammatory activity. A number of gold thiolates have been used to treat rheumatoid arthritis, although little is known about their mode of action. However, they are slow to act and it can be several months before any beneficial effects are noticed. Furthermore, with the exception of Aronofin, which is administered orally, they are given by a painful intramuscular injection. The antimicrobial activity of sulfadiazine, chloroquine, chlorotrimazole may be due to either of the presence of a toxic metal ion or a biologically active ligand. For example, silver sulfadiazine is used clinically as a topical antifungicide and also antibacterial. It appears to depend for its action on the release of a toxic silver ion rather than the sulfadiazine ligand. A complex of ruthenium with chloroquine shown a significantly increased activity of the parent drug against Plasmodium falciparum, a parasite that causes malaria, while a complex of ruthenium with chlorotrimazole exhibits up to 90% increase in the parent drug's inhibition of Trypanosoma cruzi, which is a cause of Chagas disease. Aluminium, gallium, and iron complexes are also active against Plasmodium falciparum. Certain metal complexes, such as trans cisplatin, when irradiated with visible light, that is lambda greater than 375 nanometers, increases the toxicity of this complex to bladder cancer cells. Furthermore, some inactive metal complexes have been converted into an active form by irradiation. For example, lutetium and gadolinium dextrofurans are anti-tumor agents. These compounds exhibit a selectivity of 10:1 for tumor cells, which is much greater than 3:1 exhibited by the porphyrins normally used in photodynamic therapy, that is PDT. Coming to surface tension. Surface tension is the attractive force in liquids that pulls surface molecules into the rest of the liquid, minimizing the surface area. Surface tension depends mainly upon the forces of attraction between the particles within the given liquid and also upon the gas, solid, or liquid in contact with it. The molecules in a drop of water, for example, attract each other weakly. In the figure, molecules in the inferior of a liquid are attracted in all directions, but molecules at the surface have a net inward attraction that results in the surface tension. Amphiphiles are compounds that have a region in their molecules that likes a solvent, that is, which dissolves in it, and also a region that dislikes the same solvent, that is, insoluble in that solvent. Surface tension of water can be reduced by a surfactant at lower concentrations. They are frequently used to prepare aqueous solutions of compounds that are insoluble or sparingly soluble in water. Their structures contain both strong hydrophilic or polar group and strong hydrophobic group, that is, a non-polar group, and so they dissolve in both polar and non-polar solvents. The hydrophobic part of the structure of the surfactant binds to the compound, and the strong water affinity of the hydrophobic part of the surfactant effectively pulls the compound into the solution in the water. This behavior is also the basis of detergent action. The surfactant molecules, that is detergent, bind to the dirt particles, and the strong water affinity of their polar groups pulls the dirt particles into suspension in water. This solubilizing effect of surfactants is also of considerable importance in the drug design of dosage forms. Examples of surfactants. Surfactants are classified as cationic, anionic, ampholytic, and non-ionic surfactants depending on the nature of their hydrophilic groups. Cationic surfactants have a positively charged hydrophilic group, while anionic surfactants have a negatively charged hydrophilic group. Ampholytic surfactants have electrically neutral structures that contain both positive and negative charges. They are Zwitter ions, which have both the positive as well as negative charges in the same molecule. Non-ionic surfactants do not form ions in solution. The term amphiphile and surfactant are frequently used interchangeably. In biological systems, surfactants dissolve in both aqueous medium and lipid membranes, and so tend to accumulate at the interfaces between these phases. This property is the reason for the antiseptic and disinfectant action of some non-ionic and quaternary ammonium surfactants. Examples include cetylpyridinium chloride, octoxynol 9, and nonoxynol 9. Nonoxynols and octoxynols contain different numbers of ethylene oxide units in their structures. In each case, the number after the name indicates the average number of ethylene oxide units, that is N, per molecule in the prepared sample. Surfactants such as cetylpyridinium chloride and octoxynol 9 partially dissolve in the lipid membrane of the target cell. This lowers the surface tension of the cell membrane, which results in lysis and the death of the cell. Octoxynol 9 and nonoxynol 9 are different from other surfactant antiseptics in that they do not dissolve in the cell membranes of pathogens. They dissolve in the cell membranes of only spermatozoa. This immobilizes the sperm, which allows these compounds to be used as spermicides in birth control. Naturally occurring surfactants are involved in a number of bodily functions. For example, bile salts, which are produced in the livers, play an essential part in the digestion of lipids in the intestine. Surfactants produced in the membranes of the alveoli prevents the accumulation of water and mucus in the lungs. Furthermore, a number of drugs with structures that contain a suitable balance between hydrophobic and hydrophilic groups have also been reported to exhibit surfactant properties. At the concentration of a surfactant dissolved in water increases, the system changes from a true solution to a colloidal solution. The surfactant molecules find it more energetically favorable to form colloidal aggregates known as micelles, in which the hydrophobic sections of the molecules effectively form a separate organic phase with the hydrophilic part of the molecule in the aqueous medium. The concentration at which micelles begin to form is known as the critical micelle concentration, abbreviated as CMC. It is temperature dependent and is usually measured at 25 degrees centigrade. For example, the CMC, that is critical micelle concentration for sodium dodecyl sulfate, is about 0.08 moles per diem at 25 degrees centigrade. At concentrations just above the CMC, the micelles tend to be spherical in shape. As the concentration increases, the micelle changes from a sphere to cylindrical, laminar, and other forms. Micelles may also be formed when the temperature of a constant concentration of a surfactant is varied. The temperature at which micelle formation occurs is known as the critical micelle temperature, that is CMT. Many of the physical properties of surfactant solutions, such as surface tension, electrical conductivity, and osmotic pressure, exhibit an abrupt change at the CMC point. Consequently, changes in these physical measurements can be used to indicate the onset of micelle formation and also determine the CMC value for a surfactant. However, the actual value will depend on the physical property used to determine the CMC point. The most widely used method is based on surface tension measurements. Now, coming to protein binding. Only the unbound free drug is pharmacologically active, and that only in this form it can cross a biological membrane or interact with a receptor. Interaction with the receptor results in a biochemical change leading to physiological response. Drugs bind to a number of plasma proteins including albumin, lipoproteins, alpha 1 acid glycoprotein, and gamma globulins. And the more extensively the drug is bound, the lower will be the drug activity available to exert a pharmacological effect. Since the concentrations of these proteins change in disease and as a function of nutrition, the effect of the drug may be significantly and unpredictably modulated. For example, most antimicrobials bind primarily to albumin, while basic drugs including erythromycin, clindamycin, and trimethoprim bind to the acute phase serum protein, that is alpha 1 acid glycoprotein. Moreover, binding is not limited to proteins in the serum because albumin is the principal protein in interstitial fluid. Substantial binding to this protein and to the other tissue constituents takes place. Differential concentrations of these proteins and cell debris leads to marked alterations in peripheral concentrations around an inflamed area such as a wound or abscess. For example, drugs with a low percentage of protein binding will have a higher plasma concentration of the free drug and so will be more readily available for metabolism and excretion and to exert either a therapeutic or toxic effect than drugs with a high percentage plasma protein binding. However, in the latter case, the high percentage of protein binding could result in a longer duration of action as the drug is released from the protein over a longer period of time. The degree affected by pathological states such as renal failure and inflammation or a change in physiological status due to pregnancy, fasting, and malnutrition. In addition, competition from other drugs can also affect binding. They may have clinical implications. For example, a number of drugs can displace warfarin from its albumin binding sites, which increases the concentration of warfarin in the blood. This increased concentration can lead to an increase in clot formation time, that is prothrombin, and a subsequent increase in the possibility of hemorrhage. The table shows some common drugs with their percentage of protein binding capacity. These are all the references of this lecture. With this, we end a full topic of physicochemical properties in relation to biological activity. In these three lectures, we covered the properties such as solubility, partition coefficient, ionization, dissociation constant, resonance and inductive effect, oxidation reduction potentials, types of bonding, including covalent bond, hydrogen bond, van der Waals bond, ionic bond and hydrophobic bonds, isosterism and bioisosterism, molecular dimensions and interatomic distances, stereochemistry, molar refractivity, drug shape, complexation, surface tension and protein binding, and all these physicochemical properties and their influence on the biological activity. That is all in this video. I will come up with a new topic in the next lecture. Keep learning and keep watching my videos. If you like the video, please click on like, share to your friends and colleagues, and do subscribe the channel for my upcoming videos. Thank you for watching this video.